curves and all your edges, all your perfect imperfections. Give your all to me, give my all to you. You're my end and my beginning, even when I lose, I'm winning. 'Cause I give you all of me, and you give me all of you. I give you all of me, and you give me all of you. Oh.
Only need the light when it's burning low. Only miss the sun when it starts to snow. Only know you love her when you let her go. Only know you've been high when you're feeling low. Only hate the road when you're missing home. Only know you love her when you let her go. And you let her go. The bottom of your glass, hoping one day you'll make a dream last. But dreams come slow and they go so fast. You see it when you close your eyes. Maybe one day you'll understand why everything you touch surely dies. But you only need the light when it's burning low. Only miss the sun when it starts to snow. Only know you love her when you let her go. Only know you've been high when you're feeling low. Only hate the road when you're missing home. Only know you love her when you let her go.
We're gonna get started. Yeah, that's right. I've got Bill and Cece Bees in the front row. They're my enforcers. If anybody wants to get lippy, they're coming at you. All right, let us pray in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Good and loving God, we give you thanks and praise for this night. We give you thanks and praise for this gathering. We give you thanks and praise, Jesus, for your heart given to us in the week of the bridegroom. Lord, I ask you, I beg you to pour your Holy Spirit upon me, weak and imperfect instrument that I am, that you would use my poverty as a channel of your riches, that you use my brokenness as a channel of your wholeness, that you would use my imperfection as a channel for your perfection. We heard in that first reading from Isaiah, let me preach a word that would rouse them. Lord, that's my desire tonight. Rouse our hearts into awe and wonder. And we give this night to our blessed Queen and Mother as we pray together. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Our Lady Guadalupe, St. John Paul the Great, St. Joseph, Terror of Demons, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, friends, again, if we're standing room only at this point, if you want to stand the whole time, you're welcome to. But we do have overflow seating upstairs. The live stream is going upstairs, too. So thank you for coming out tonight for our one-night Lenten parish mission. Give it up for yourselves for coming out, making the effort. There you go. I'm very, very grateful. And I'm just going to come out of the gate and rip the Band-Aid off and just say this, that as many of you have probably already heard by now, this is my last year with you at Sacred Heart. I know. The bishop responds to about 10 letters a week, he said, so thank you. So I'll be transferring come June, and once that's all public, I'll let you know where I'm going. But with all of that in mind, with this being my last Holy Week with you, my last everything with you, I'm just so honored and delighted to be delivering this one-night Lenten parish mission to you, my family, right? The people that I have loved with everything I have and who have loved me so well. It is true that, like, the seminary forms priests, but it's parishes that really do the finishing touches. And I'm just so grateful for the formation. Yes?
There's no
video. Okay. Dan, could you take a look at that upstairs? Yeah. All right. I'm so grateful for the formation that, I mean, the opportunity to love you has been the greatest privilege of my life. So I'm just so honored. I love this parish so much. And all I want to do tonight is I just want to give you everything in me. This talk is, in some ways, it's all the things that I want to give you going into this week. It's all of the gold. From the image from the homily I preached tonight, it's the alabaster jar of my heart broken open. I want to pour out all the nard. I want to pour out everything that I have, which means, at points tonight, you're going to feel like you're drinking from a fire hydrant. So I don't want you, I know some of you got notes ready to go, and that's great, but I don't want you to feel like you need to be a court stenographer and take down everything I'm saying. That's not going to help you. The prayer going into this is, Lord, help me to hear and receive what you want me to hear and receive. And most often, it's probably not going to be something that I'm saying, but something that the Holy Spirit is saying. You want to pay attention to that. I don't have the words of everlasting life. He does. I can't promise you a break because I got a lot I want to share. We might do one. Maybe not. I'll feel it out. So we're just going to be really cozy with each other for 2 hours is really what this is. Okay, all that to say is this, that feel free, though, at any point to get up, you know, scooch past your people in your row. Go get more drinks, more food if it's all back there. By the way, let's give a round of applause for Jess Allen for setting all of that up. I don't know where she is. The hospitality details have been just so awesome. I've been just so grateful for help. If you're not from Sacred Heart, if you're looking for a bathroom at any point, men's room is right here, women's room is right down the hall. And again, feel free to get up at any point. I won't be offended. Feel free to you know, if you want to just snooze, that's fine too. We'll just assume that you're like really holy and like St. Joseph, you know, that the Lord's giving you something very holy in your dream, right? All right, so this is where we're going to start. We're going to take you back to the year 2017. I, along with 10 other priests, went on a pilgrimage to the Holy Land. So I'm this cool dude right here in the khakis. I didn't get the memo that we were all supposed to wear clerics on this trip. Everywhere we went, there was like 10 priests and some guy in khakis. Oh, well. I would have survived, you know, if they took them out. Anyway. So it was an amazing, amazing, life-changing trip, and God willing, if we ever get to go back to the Holy Land, I'm going back as soon as I can. You should go if you ever get the opportunity. It was an incredible, life-changing experience. Very, very full days, packed itinerary, tons of walking, tons of hiking, up and down hills. and you get exhausted. Like when they say in the scriptures, let us go up to Jerusalem, it's not like, it's not just simply a, you know, a destination waypoint. It literally is up. It's a mountain. Like everything is uphill both ways. It is exhausting. So on day four of this trip, on day four, we ended by going to the Basilica of All Nations, which is built over the Garden of Gethsemane, right? So you've got the ancient olive grove, the olive trees that have been basically in existence since the time of Jesus, surrounding the basilica, and the basilica is built over, the altar is built over, I'll show you in a moment, the rock upon which the Lord entered into his agony. Incredible. So we were there at the end of the day. Our group joined up this group of Mexican pilgrims who were there by their archbishop, that old guy on the right side of the altar. And so we were doing a Eucharistic holy hour in Gethsemane with this Mexican tour group. So the archbishop would get up, and every once in a while he would, you know, preach just like a two-minute little fervorino, a little homily reflection, little two-minute thing. And I speak Spanish. I can understand Spanish. So the first couple of these, I was sitting there translating in my head, like, you know, getting what he's saying. And then I just got to a point where, like, you know, I'm a little bit tired. I'm just gonna take it in. I'm just not going to translate. I'm just going to sit there. And I have my hands like this, and then I put my head down. Whoa, I feel the judgment coming at me so strong. So I closed my eyes, and I leaned my head down, and before I knew it, I, like many other great and heroic and amazing saints before me, I was asleep in the Garden of Gethsemane during a holy hour with Jesus right there. Can you not stay awake 1 hour? No, is the answer. No, I can't. So I'm sitting there, and it was either my snoring or my buddy priest next to me who woke me up. I think it was my snoring, but my snoring woke me up, and I realized what had just happened, that I fell asleep in the one place you're not supposed to fall asleep praying a holy hour. And I started laughing. I'm like, I can't believe myself. I am the worst, right? It's just so bad. So I started laughing, but then I closed my eyes, and then I'm not joking. The Lord opened up, I don't want to call it a mystical vision, but it was like a mystical vision. That's all I know how to say. He opened up this scene for me that I really want to set the scene for us tonight. So this is the rock in front of the altar upon which the Lord agonized. And as I had my eyes closed, I began to hear in the faint distance the sound of, like, dripping. And I just was following the image, following the sound, and it brought me to like a profile view of Jesus' face. He's face down essentially on this rock, on his forearms. And I have this like close up zoom in on his nose, and I can see the blood coming down his forehead, pooling on the tip of his nose and falling onto the rock and just pooling on the rock. And then I saw the enemy come in from the other side, kind of like that scene in The Passion. And I hear the enemy whisper to Jesus, pointing to the blood on the rock that's just pooling there. I hear him say, just like all their hearts, your sacrifice is in vain. They won't receive you. It's not going to soak in. Why bother? Nobody is going to receive this gift. Like, I'm convinced that some of the greatest agony that he suffered in the garden was the suffering of thinking about the unrequited love, right? When Jesus talks about the seed that gets scattered, some on the path, some on amongst the thorns, some amongst rocky ground, that's a very personal parable to him. It's very personal. It's not just an agricultural analogy. He's talking about himself. And 3/4 of the seed, it falls among soil that's insufficient to receive him. He says, but some seed falls among fertile soil. I want to share so much with you tonight, so much about, if you could peel back the layers and peer at the mystery behind the history, I want us to see the mystical depths of these days, so that we can be that fertile soil, so that we can receive deeply and drink in deeply as much as possible. Right? Jesus says in the Gospels of the crowds, he says, they look, but they do not see. I want us to see what is really taking place in these days. So that, again, unlike the rock of the agony, that our hearts would be good fertile soil to receive and conceive what he died to give us. So what is mystically taking place in these days? In a word, and this is what we're going to be unpacking this entire night, in one word, nuptials, a spousal mystery. It's a love story beyond our wildest imaginings. Holy Week, right? Holy Week is referred to by the Eastern Rite churches of the Catholic Church. It's referred to as the Week of the Bridegroom. We in the Latin Church, we're just like, Holy Week. We stink at naming things. The Week of the Bridegroom. I want us to understand why they call it that. I want us to understand why. And it begins here. This is where we're beginning our journey tonight. With the scene that we had at the beginning of our long passion narrative today, right? 6 days before Passover, Jesus came to Bethany. While he was reclining at the table, a woman approached him with an alabaster jar of costly, genuine nard. She broke the jar and poured it on his head. In pouring this perfumed oil upon my body, she did it to prepare me for burial. Amen, I say to you, wherever the gospel is proclaimed in the whole world, what she has done will be spoken of in memory of her. Those are some extraordinary lines from our Lord, that wherever it's proclaimed, what she has done will be recalled in memory of her. This has to be significant, right? This has to be significant. So she comes into the house, she pours the nard on Jesus' head. John's gospel says the feet. This is where we got the feet. I personally like the head version. I don't know. That's just what I like. So what is nard? We're going to talk about this. What is nard? This side gets to pass around this dish. Here you go, Keith. Give a little sniff and pass it. Bill, can I trust you? This is glass. Maybe. It's made of glass, Bill. Okay, all right. So what is nard? Nard is this gloriously fragrant, pungent. There's just a few drops on these cotton balls. It's gloriously fragrant, pungent perfume that comes from a rare flower that grows in the Himalayas. So it's very, very expensive. Grows high up in the Himalayas. And this woman comes in, and the scripture said she pours a liter of this juice on this guy's head. She pours a liter of this nard on Jesus' head. Think about that. Like, I don't wear colognes. It's been a long time since I've worn a cologne. I'm a celibate. Just saying. But I looked up, I just searched like a modern cologne, and this is what I found. So I don't know if this is a good cologne or not. Clive Christian Original Collection Number 1. Anybody wear that? Okay. A 50 milliliter bottle sells for $1,000. A 50 milliliters, $1,000. She pours a liter of this, and Jesus says, in pouring this, she did this to prepare me for burial, and wherever the gospel is proclaimed, what she has done will be spoken of in memory of her. This has got to be important. So biblically speaking, the word nard appears in 3 books of the Bible. It appears in Mark's gospel, it appears in John's gospel. We heard the word today in Mass. It appears in John's gospel, and the other 2 times, the other appearances are in 1 book from the Old Testament. From the Song of Songs. This night is brought to you by the Song of Songs, in many ways, just so you know. What is nard? Biblically speaking, in the Song of Songs, nard is the fragrance of the bride in the Song of Songs. It's the fragrance of the bride opening her heart and her body to the bridegroom. We hear this in the Song of Songs, chapter 1, verse 12. While the king was upon his couch, my nard gave forth its fragrance. And in Song of Songs, chapter 4, you are a garden enclosed, my sister, my bride, with fruits of choicest yield, henna with nard, nard and saffron, sweet cane and cinnamon. Like the mysterious heart of the bride and the depth of her body, right? They're all described symbolically, allegorically, with the fragrance of nard. Nard is associated with her heart and with her body. It's associated with the depth of her mystery, the very place where the bridegroom wants to get in. It's associated with the depth of her femininity. And right there in Song of Songs chapter 4, right, that thing that I just read, I'll read it again. You are a garden enclosed. You are a garden enclosed, my sister, my bride, with fruits of choicest yield, henna with nard, nard and saffron, sweet cane and cinnamon. Do you notice that double, that couplet, that nard, nard, henna with nard, comma, nard and saffron. This double usage of nard right here in the Song of Songs, this is so significant. The Song of Songs, if you were to take your Bible and essentially crack it in half, you're going to end up in the Song of Songs. The Song of Songs is essentially the center of the Bible. And the center of the center is the double repetition of that word nard, nard. The center, center fulcrum of the Bible is nard, nard. It was Mikhail Waldstein, who was he was a friend of John Paul II. He was the great interpreter of John Paul II's theology of the body. It was Waldstein who pointed out this double couplet of nard, nard. That it's the significance of it, that the Bible, the first half of the Bible, ends with nard, and the beginning of the second half of the Bible begins with nard. The whole thing is, its fulcrum point is this mystery of the depth of femininity, the very place where the bridegroom wants to put his life, right there in the center, right there in the center. So why did the Holy Spirit inspire the Song of Songs to be the center of the Bible? Let's look at the beginning, let's look at the end. The Bible begins with the book of? And it ends with the book of? Okay, very good. Who brought a Bible tonight, by the way? Oh, come on, Catholics! You're killing me! No! I don't want to hear it in your phone. The Word became flesh. We need to correct that thought that Catholics are not Bible people. This is our book. This is our book. All right. Shame. All right, moving on. All right, so the Bible begins, book of Genesis. The Bible begins with a marriage of an earthly couple in an earthly paradise. And the Bible concludes with the marriage of Christ the Lamb to his bride, the church, in a heavenly paradise. The bookends of the Bible are matrimony. They're spousal. The Bible begins with spousal mystery. The Bible ends with spousal mystery. Smack dab in the middle is the Song of Songs. And in the middle of the middle is nard, nard. It was Pope Benedict XVI, another sponsor of tonight's mission. Pope Benedict XVI, speaking about the Song of Songs, right? He says, these love songs ultimately describe God's relation to man and man's relation to God. Thus, he says, the Song of Songs became, both in Christian and Jewish literature, a source of mystical knowledge and experience, an expression of the essence of biblical faith, that man can indeed enter into union with God, his primordial aspiration. Primordial, meaning like the depth of our humanity, the very origin, the very depth of our destiny, right? We are ordered towards union with God. And the Song of Songs, he says, expresses the essence of biblical faith. This book, which is the only book in the entire Bible that doesn't mention God by name, this book, which has more commentaries written on it than any other book in the entire Bible. Did you know that? More than the Gospels, more than the book of Revelation, more than the Psalms. Like, the Song of Songs takes up so much shelf space in the annals of church history and the church fathers and the mystics. Bernard of Clairvaux, he basically did two things in his life. He established monasteries and he wrote commentaries on the Song of Songs. That's about it, among other things. But that's basically what he did, right? That's basically what he did. This book, he says, this book, which is expressive of this glorious love poetry, the longing of a bridegroom for his bride, a bride for her bridegroom, this book that has images that make anybody blush when you read it, especially if it's read in church of all places. That should not be read in church, right? And if there's any single guys in here, there's some great Catholic pickup lines in the Song of Songs. Your belly is a bushel of wheat, my darling. I don't know any lady who doesn't want to hear that, right? Your teeth are ewes and all of them twins. In other words, you got all your teeth, and I like it. That's probably why I'm a celibate. Anyway, the Pope is saying that this book expresses the essence of biblical faith. Rabbi Akiba, who was a rabbi from the first century, he said this, that all of Scripture is holy, but the Song of Songs is the holy of holies. The holy of holies. I heard a right there. Here's the question. What are these guys seeing that most of us are not seeing? Would most of us readily jump to that conclusion? The Song of Songs, essence of biblical faith. What are they seeing that most of us are not seeing? Let's press in a little bit further. Back to the other sponsor for the night, John Paul II, Pope John Paul II. Pope John Paul II says this. He's writing now about Paul's letter to the Ephesians, chapter 5. He says, St. Paul's magnificent synthesis concerning the great mystery, I'll say more about that in a second, appears as the compendium, or the summa, in some sense, of the teaching about God and man, which was brought to fulfillment by Christ. John Paul II, he goes on to say this, that the mystery spoken of in Ephesians 5, right? Ephesians 5, where we hear, husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church, right? That whole thing. But then he says, for this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother, be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. Paul's quoting Genesis. Then he adds this, this is a great mystery, but I speak in reference to Christ and the church. That's St. Paul's magnificent synthesis, right? The mystery spoken of in Ephesians 5 is great indeed. As God's salvific plan for humanity, that mystery, Ephesians 5, is in some sense this central theme of the whole of Revelation, its central reality. It is what God wishes above all to transmit to mankind in His Word. What is it, you ask, that God wants to transmit to mankind in His Word? That God wants union with you. He wants union with you. He's not merely interested in a friendship with you. Friendship is great. That's not the peak or the pinnacle of human relationship. He wants a relationship with you that the least inadequate analogy, this side of heaven, is that of spousal love. He's saying, I want to be espoused to you for all eternity. I want to be implicated in your life. I want my life to be in you. I want my joy to be in you. Like, this is what John Paul II calls the spousal analogy, that God wants a spousal type relationship with us. Now, of course, all analogies limp. All analogies limp. So should we just throw this one out? No. No. Jesus uses a lot of different analogies to describe his relationship to humanity. He calls himself the shepherd. We're the sheep. I'm the vine. You're the branches. Here's the problem. Jesus wasn't incarnate as a vine. He wasn't incarnate as a mother hen who just wants to gather her chicks beneath her wings. These are other analogies, other metaphors. Jesus was, in fact, incarnate as a man who came to offer his life for a bride. This is not just one metaphor, one analogy among many. This is how this works, that the love and the reality of the triune God and the relationship that Jesus has with the church, that is the most real thing. And God, stammering, trying to say, okay, here's the best way I can describe who we are and how we want to relate to you. He's saying, it's like spousal love. That's what I'm like. That's what this relationship is like. It's like spousal love. It's the least inadequate analogy that God compares his love to us as a bridegroom to a bride. The entire Bible is telling this love story. The entire thing is telling this love story. From beginning to end, God saying, I want a union with you that's like that of spouses. I want to be implicated in all that is yours. I want to impregnate your heart with divine life. I want my life to be in you. The saints, the mystics of the church, when they have these powerful experiences of the Lord in prayer, when they're looking for images to unpack what they've experienced, they don't reach for the images from the Psalms. They're not like Teresa of Avila. She has this powerful encounter with Jesus in prayer. And she's looking through the scriptures, and it's not as though she's like, oh man, I just felt like a sheep in the arms of my shepherd. She's like, that's not what it was like. She had this experience where this angel appears to her. What does this angel look like, by the way? Think secular. Cupid. Cupid is the Roman god of love. What's his Greek correlate? What's his name? Eros. We're going to talk more about Eros. She has this image of God's angel with this flaming dart appearing to her, and this angel is plunging this flaming dart into her heart over and over again. And she says, I was filled with such agony, I wished to stop immediately. And I was filled with such ecstasy, I wished it to go on forever. They call this the transverberation. Bernini, he's the one who sculpted this moment in stone. Does that look like a sheep in the arms of a shepherd? Mm-mm. This looks like the Song of Songs, right? After she died, the sisters exhumed her heart. They removed her heart, and on her heart, there was a cauterized scar. This wasn't just like a spiritual, in my mind, in my soul kind of event. This happened to her. God's love piercing her, piercing her. God wants union with you. He wants his life in you. That's the story. And where does the story crescendo? On the cross, like what is happening on Good Friday? Not simply his murder. It's nuptials. It's the marriage between heaven and earth. And that union of the bridegroom and the bride on the cross, that union is fertile as the bridegroom gives forth from his heart the divine seed of eternal life. I'm a very visual person, and I so appreciate how artists are able to depict some of these mystical realities. So I want to show you this image. It's called the Unity Cross. It's a beautiful image of Jesus and his Blessed Mother on Good Friday, and she's right there in his side, holding up to his lanced and open heart a chalice. This artist has made visible what is happening on the cross. He's made visible this mystical marriage, this mystical union of the bridegroom and the bride. I know you're thinking, I thought that was his mother. She is. In the order of nature, she is always his mother, but in the order of grace, the catechism says she is the mystical bride. We'll say more about that in a moment. This unity cross, what we see, right, is the bridegroom and the bride. We see the new Adam and the new Eve. The new Adam failed in his post, and he hid himself. Or the old Adam failed at his post, and he hid himself. The new Adam exposes himself. The old Adam failed on a tree. The new Adam goes to a tree. This is the tree of life. What do we say in the Hail Mary? Blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. What was promised all the way back in Genesis? There was two trees, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil and the tree of life. We were always meant to receive the fruit. We were never meant to grasp it. Jesus is the fruit that hangs from the tree of life. That's what the cross is. Mary is the new Eve. The first Eve closed herself. The new Eve opens herself. The first Eve said no. The new Eve says yes. She opens herself so fully, so completely, that she receives the flow of life that comes from the heart of God. Mary is the personal face of the church. She's the personal face of the church. Before the church was organized in Peter, the church existed in Mary. I know we always say that Pentecost is the church's birthday. Not true. It's the Annunciation. Which, if it wasn't for solar eclipses and weird Easters, we'd be celebrating tomorrow. Tomorrow. What do we say? What does the priest say to you at Mass during the preface? Lift up your hearts. And you say? Lift up the Lord. That's about what it sounds like to me, too. Yeah. We lift them up to the Lord. You didn't bring your Bibles. We lift them up to the Lord. The heart is an open space. The heart is an open space. It's the only concavity you have in you to hold anything. The heart is the organ of longing, Pope Benedict says. It's a chalice. And none of us have really impressive chalices, like the scene in Indiana Jones, right? The cup of the carpenter, right? We all want our hearts to look like all those gold chalices. It's like this rinky-dink made out of Play-Doh by some third grader named Jimmy, right? This is what it looks like to lift up our hearts to the Lord. You are lifting up your capacity to receive. That's what this is. This is what that means. Fulton Sheen, my great hero, Fulton Sheen, he says this, that whenever Jesus calls Mary woman, whenever Jesus calls Mary woman, there he is, we are at a wedding. We're at a wedding. There's two times where Jesus calls Mary woman. The first time is the first miracle at the wedding feast of Cana. And the second time is from the cross where he looks at Mary and says, "Woman, behold your son." Both times are a wedding. The wedding feast of Cana, the problem is the couple has run out of wine. I hope that's not a problem for us tonight. I have to pray over some water. They ran out of wine. Wine in the scriptures is this rich symbol of God's love, his love poured out. It's the fact that they've run out of wine is a symbol of original sin, right? She comes to Jesus. Eve comes to the new Adam. She says, they have no more wine. And Jesus basically responds, woman, if you translate the Greek, it's literally like, what to me to thee? Like, what are you asking me to do? He's basically saying, am I to reveal my relationship to you now? Am I to reveal who I am now? My hour has not yet come. We heard it in the gospel tonight. Jesus declares it. The hour has come. So he's dragged out of Gethsemane. But there in Cana, my hour has not yet come. It will come in the passion, on the cross, when the bridegroom provides the new wine of his divine love. That's the hour when the wine of divine love is poured out on the whole world. Out of the open and lanced heart of the bridegroom comes the flow of blood and water. And we're about to take a step down. There's going to be a few moments tonight where we're like, going to take another step down into the depths. This is one of those steps. That flow of blood and water is, according to St. Augustine, it's his spiritual seminal fluid. It's the bridegroom's divine seed. And the bride, back to the image, the bride is opening the chalice of her longing to receive from his heart. This is the mystical marriage, right? In Catholic theology, the principle is simply this, that grace builds on nature, that the natural order of things is a sign of the supernatural order. So, the life-giving power, the life-giving potency of every man, of every earthly father, is a sign that points to the ever greater, infinitely more powerful, life-giving seed of the divine God and Father. Like, what do we say in the Creed when we speak about the Holy Spirit? I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life. What kind of life? Not just natural life, divine life. Divine life. Eternal life. Superabounding life. Unending life. And where does that life, where does that love flow? Where does it come from? It comes, all the saints of our tradition have said the same thing. It comes from the open heart of Jesus. It comes from the lanced and open heart of the bridegroom. Catherine of Siena, another great saint and doctor of the church, she had this mystical experience with Jesus where she was invited to drink deeply from his side. This comes from her journals. And putting his right hand on her virginal neck and drawing her towards the wound in his own side, he whispered to her, "Drink, daughter, the liquid from my side, and it will fill your soul with such sweetness that its wonderful effects will be felt even by the body, which for my sake you despised." And she, finding herself thus near to the source of the fountain of life, put the lips of her body, but much more those of her soul, over the most holy wound, and long and eagerly and abundantly drank that indescribable and unfathomable liquid. Finally, at a sign from the Lord, she detached herself from the fountain, sated, yet at the same time still longing for more. What? In John's gospel, Jesus makes this, it just flies over our head, but he makes this wild invitation. He says, if anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. Have you ever considered that Jesus is not like a water fountain? What does he mean when he says, come to me and drink? This is what he means. Okay, let me hit pause. Okay, I know that some of this imagery already might be uncomfortable. I know it might be very new for some of us, and so much of this discomfort comes from the fact that there is an enemy, right? And if what I'm saying is true, then if you were the enemy, the thing that you would attack the most is all of this embodiment stuff, human sexuality stuff. If you were the enemy, the thing that you would attack is the lens that makes sense of who we are and who God is. Welcome to our world, amen? So if right now, if we're hearing these things, and we're hearing them being applied to the deepest mysteries of our faith, and we think, oh my gosh, like, no, that's not how Jesus wants to love me. I don't think that's how I want Jesus. I don't want Jesus to love me like that. I want him to be like my companion, my friend, my general. And I understand. So let's just take a second. Let's ask the Holy Spirit to come in power right now. Come, Holy Spirit, untwist in us any distortions, any lies, any deceptions from the enemy, anything that's been twisted up. Jesus, Holy Spirit, come now and untwist in us tonight that we might see who you are and what you've done. Friends, we always have to recall that these are mystical realities. These are mystical realities, and these are analogies revealed by Christ, right? So let me just state it clearly. Like Catherine of Siena here, she's not a vampire, okay? She's not a in my head, that was a funnier laugh. I don't want it. She's not a vampire, she's a mystic, right? She's a mystic. That does not mean that she just like floated off into this ethereal world of made up make-believe land, right? We can't just dismiss her as like, oh, she's a mystic. Do you know the church teaches that all of us are called to be mystics? Some of us might experience the extraordinary signs of mystical life, but every person is called to be an ordinary mystic. We can't dismiss her and say, nah, that's just for you, old saint lady. No. Sorry, Catherine. Sometimes I don't know what comes out of my mouth, okay? She was a mystic who drank deeply of the love of Christ, and it affected her body, right? Just like Teresa of Avila, that experience, it affected not just her soul, it affected her body. Because I don't know if you know this, but we are body and soul. That might be news to some people in this room. I don't know. All right. So Pope Benedict, we're going to switch gears again back to our first sponsor, Pope Benedict. Pope Benedict said in his first encyclical, Deus Caritas Est, God is love. Amazing encyclical. I love so much, right? The Pope Benedict, he was Cardinal Joseph Ratzinger. He was the prefect for the Congregation for the Doctrine of Faith. He was the church's theological watchdog for decades. He was regarded as the Panzer Cardinal, right? He was this very intense, he's gonna be a saint, I'm convinced of it. Saint, mystic, all these things. But he was regarded as like this very scary German, right? He's a German shepherd in Rome, right? And his first encyclical is on love. I love that so much, right? Deus Caritas Est. In that encyclical, he says that God's love for us, it certainly is agape, which is one of the Greek words for love. Agape meaning this self-emptying, self-giving kind of love, right? Think of Jesus, his kenosis that Paul talks about in his letters to the Philippians today. This gift, this emptying of love for the other. But Pope Benedict added this, that God's love for us is not just agape. He said God's love for us is also Eros. God's love for us is eros, which was where we get the word erotic, but we have to reclaim the language. Don't confuse eros and the erotic with its distortion, porneia, which is the twisting of eros, right? It's where we get the word pornography, right? So Pope Benedict, he defines eros as this. He says, eros is that force within us, which does not allow the lover to remain in himself, but it moves him to become one with the beloved. The desire for the true, the good, the beautiful, eros is part of God's very heart. The passion of the love of the bridegroom. The Almighty, he says, awaits the yes of his creatures as a young bridegroom awaits the yes of his bride. Holy Week, the week of the bridegroom, this is God kneeling before your heart, begging you to be fertile soil, Christ yearning for us to open our hearts to him. Like Mary, open, open. Pope Benedict said that you could summarize Jesus and his entire mission as Messiah and bridegroom when he spoke to that deaf mute man and he said, Ephatha, that is be opened. Be opened, right? Like, look at these baby birds. This is what he wants us to be. Like these baby birds, beaks open, stretching, straining, right? David the psalmist, he says, open wide your mouth, the Lord says, and I will fill it. I will fill it. Christ yearns for us to open our humanity, to crack open our hearts, to let him in. But this is where we get afraid, because we say, by the way, how's that nard doing? Is it smelling good? Where is it in the room right now? Did it go all the way back? Bill, do you still have it? This is where we get afraid. We start fearing. We think like, okay, if I open my heart, it's not going to smell like nard. It's going to smell like sewage. Who's seen Shawshank Redemption? If you haven't seen it, that's your homework. You got to see it. Okay. It's an intense movie, but man, is it, it's the gospel. It's beautiful. There's a scene in Shawshank. I'm just about to spoil the movie, I guess. So there's this guy named Andy Dufresne who escapes. It's kind of the punchline of the movie. Okay, but there's a scene where he's got this rock and he's escaping by pounding on this sewer pipe. He's going to escape the prison through the sewer pipe, and he's pounding on the sewer pipe during this thunderstorm, and every time he waits for a bolt of lightning and boom, he pounds, and then waits again and boom, pounds. Then eventually he hits it, and all of a sudden there's this geyser of fecal matter and sludge and nastiness that comes gushing out. And we are so afraid that if we open our hearts, that that's what's going to come out. Right? Just like in the gospel with Martha and Mary and Lazarus, and he's in the tomb. Jesus says, roll away the stone. And Martha's like, Lord, he's been in there 3 days. There's going to be a stench. Like, if we learn anything from Jesus in that story, is that he's not afraid of the stench of your hearts. Holy Thursday, Jesus is going to disrobe himself and get down and wash the apostles' feet. What do you think those feet smelled like? I just do like an honorary, like symbolic foot washing. Like I'm not getting in between the toes, you know? I'm not doing it. But like the connotation of the verb in the Gospel of John is that he's like washing their feet. He's not afraid of the stench. Absolutely not afraid. He's born in a stable. Roll away the stone. He's just not afraid of the stench in your heart. He's not afraid. He's awaiting our yes like a bridegroom awaiting the yes of his bride. Right? Pope Benedict, he continues, he says this, on the cross, God's eros, God's passionate love, his pursuing kind of love, his love that wants to reach out towards us, God's eros is made manifest for us. Then he asks this question, is there a more mad eros than that which led the Son of God to make himself one with us even to the point of suffering as his own, the consequences of our offenses. Can we imagine a more mad eros than that of God, that moved God to leave heaven, to wrap himself in human flesh and frailty, to go to war on our behalf, to suffer as his own the consequences of sin, sin that he was utterly foreign to? Can we imagine a more mad eros? Like, this was part of my, if you heard me preach this weekend, this was part of my Palm Sunday homily, like this law of excess, this law of extravagance, right? In the incarnation, Jesus becoming flesh, in the passion, the death, the resurrection of our Lord, there is an almost, I want to say, an uncalculated madness, an uncalculated recklessness to his love. In this mad eros, he comes after us. He comes for us to be united to us, his bride on the cross, in order to regenerate humanity in this mystical union. After Christ says those words, we hear him in English as, "It is finished." But I don't know if y'all knew this. The Bible wasn't written in English, right? Greek, you have tetelestai. And when St. Jerome translated the Greek into his Latin Vulgate, he translated those words as it, or consummatum est. It is consummated. It is consummated. And then we hear, as we heard in the gospel tonight, that after he breathes his last, every one of the evangelists says the same thing. The veil in the temple that covered the Holy of Holies was torn in two from top to bottom, not from bottom to top. Who can tear a veil from bottom to top? Everybody. Any human being. Who can tear the veil from top to bottom? God alone, right? The veil is torn from top to bottom. Just like the nard scene at the beginning of the Passion, this is critical if we're going to understand the week of the bridegroom. What does this mean? We've just seen Jesus die on the cross, and every evangelist zooms over to the temple. The camera cuts to the temple, to the Holy of Holies, the innermost sanctum of the temple. Why? Why? Because we have to understand the connection between the temple and the human body. In particular, the temple and the bride's body. How are we doing so far? Good. Okay, good. All right. Someone say keep going. All right, good. I'll keep going. Drone footage of Jerusalem, circa 1 AD. You didn't know they had drones back then. All right, St. Paul says this, "Do you not know that your body is a temple?" He asked that question, right? What does Christ say? Tear down this temple, and in 3 days I'll rebuild it. But he says, John says, but he was speaking of the temple of his body. Right? The human body is the temple. And in a, like I said, and in a particular way, woman's body reveals the mystery of the temple and the mystery of that innermost holy place of the temple, the Holy of Holies. Did you know that in the instructions for the construction of the temple, it was designed specifically at the Lord's command, it was designed in some ways to model woman's body. I know this sounds crazy, but it's true. It's in there. You would know if you brought your Bibles. And if you read the Song of Songs, right, back in the center of the Bible, if you read the Song of Songs, when you're hearing the bridegroom talking about his bride, you're not sure if he's talking about a woman or a land or a building. Like, either this guy is terrible at adjectives, right, or terrible at compliments, or it's this mystical, like Russian nesting doll of symbolism. Right? Are you describing a woman, the land, or the building? And he would say, yes. Yes. I'm describing the bride, is what he's saying. There's a profound parallel between the temple and the Holy of Holies and woman's body, in particular, woman's womb. The temple had an outer court, an inner court, and an inner court. An outer court, an inner court, and an innermost court. Right? That innermost court is the Holy of Holies, and it was veiled by a curtain. And only the high priest could enter the Holy of Holies. Only the high priest could enter the Holy of Holies. And recall this too, that the temple was constructed just like the tabernacle in the wilderness. God spoke to Moses and said, build according to the pattern that I show you. Right? So Moses didn't just like, he wasn't just brainstorming with, you know, a bunch of fellas about what should the tabernacle look like? It was build according to the pattern that I show you. The temple was also build according to the pattern that I show you. Right, so it was a revelation of what the heavenly temple was, heavenly worship. The earthly temple was a microcosm of the heavenly temple. The earthly temple was a visible sign of the heavenly temple. You tracking with me? Okay. And the high priest alone could enter the Holy of Holies to offer sacrifice. What kind of sacrifice, you ask? Grain and seed offerings. Seed offerings. All right, let's keep our spousal lenses on here. Why does the bridegroom offer grain and seed offering? Think of the spousal analogy, right? The natural is a sign of the supernatural. It's because the bridegroom is the one who gives the gift of the seed. He's the one who gives the gift of the seed that leads to new life. That's the bridegroom's role. And what, again, is the Holy of Holies? It's the inner court of the temple, the inner court. Theologically, we could put it this way. It's the meeting place between heaven and earth. It's like the hot zone. It's where heaven approaches earth. That's what the Holy of Holies is. And all throughout the Holy of Holies, all throughout the innermost sanctum of the Holy Holies, there was this decorative symbol that was all over the place. It was an almond shape, and it's called the mandorla. The mandorla. Obviously, it's like a Venn diagram, right? It's created by the interpenetration of two circles. These two circles, they represent the two realms, the heavenly realm and the earthly realm, right? The mandorla symbolizes the joining together of heaven and earth, the marriage, if you will, of heaven and earth, how heaven and earth come together. That's what the mandorla symbolizes. Now, this mandorla, this almond shape, is also a very feminine symbol of birth and openness to new life. I have a friend who, she's a nurse on a labor and delivery floor, and I asked her, I showed her, you know, my slides, I said, does this like image remind you of like feminine openness, birth, new life? She's like, oh yeah, I basically see that shape in the delivery room every single day. I'm like, okay. Again, remember the physical reveals the invisible. The physical reveals the invisible. I guarantee you, if you start looking, you're going to start seeing this symbol, the mandorla, everywhere. This shape that represents feminine openness, birth, new life. It's all over the church's art and architecture. Let me just give you a few examples. Take a look at these. Right? This icon of Christ, the high priest, opening the gates of heaven. This is the icon of the resurrection. Notice the mandorla. Christ in glory. Even Our Lady Guadalupe. She's standing behind a mandorla, in front of a mandorla. From this ancient manuscript. Like, it's all over the place. Christ in the womb of the Virgin. This is called the Theotokos icon. It depicts Mary pregnant with Christ. Right? Christ in the womb of the Theotokos. Theotokos is Greek for God-bearer. She bore him in her womb, right? And bore him forth. So Mary, in opening her body to receive him at the Annunciation, which we would celebrate tomorrow, but we're not, and birthing him forth at Christmas, right? Woman's body, my sisters, your body has become the Holy of Holies. Woman's body is heaven on earth. If heaven is where God dwells, Mary's womb is heaven on earth. In the Eastern Rite Church, the icon that fills the back apse of Eastern Rite churches, Byzantine churches, it's called the Plati Terra icon. Right? He whom the heavens could not contain was contained in the womb of the Virgin. Mary's womb is described by the church fathers as a bridal chamber. It's the trysting place. It's the place, the meeting place between heaven and earth. It's the Holy of Holies. It's where the marriage comes together. At the Easter Vigil, in the Exultet, we'll sing, "Oh, this blessed night, when things of heaven are wed to those of earth, the divine to the human." There, in her womb. Again, if this imagery makes us uncomfortable, let's just beg the Holy Spirit, untwist the deceptions that we might believe about all this stuff. Untwist the distortions. Friends, if the incarnation is real, then woman's body has become heaven on earth. Heaven is where God dwells. This is where he dwelt. Is it any wonder then why the enemy is after what happens in your wombs, my dear sisters? Like, we talk about, the culture warriors talk about the war on women. There's only one war on women, and it's diabolical, and it's been from the beginning. He hates you because you remind him of her. You smell like her. You look like her. Your foot reminds him, the enemy, of the foot that crushed his proud head. He hates you for your femininity. Not only does God love us, right? Not only does he want us to be espoused to him for all eternity, but God wants to fill us with divine life. He wants to recreate in us what first began in her. What do we say in the Salve Regina? We speak of her as our life, our sweetness, and our hope. How is she our hope if we are never to be what she is? She holds out to us who we are called by grace to become. Mary is the burning bush of the New Testament, right? The burning bush that is on fire, but not consumed. Mary has opened herself to the divine fire, and she's not been consumed. Jesus is looking at you and me, and he's saying, "Open to me, open to me." He says in Luke's gospel, "I have come to cast fire upon the earth." And how I wish it were already blazing. He wants to put his life in us, to divinize us, to make us partakers of the divine nature. Who remembers this one? First comes love, then comes marriage, then comes
baby
in the baby carriage, right? That's good theology. It's also good morality. That's the right order. Anyway, first comes his love, then comes his espousal, then comes his desire to put his life in us, to transform us. And again, for my brothers in this room, I know this might sound crazy, but listen to your older brother in the faith, St. Paul, who wrote like a quarter of the New Testament. St. Paul said this. He said, "It is no longer I who live, it is Christ who lives in me." In the ancient world, for someone to say someone is living inside of me, even in our world today, right? You're either one of two things, really. You're either a pregnant person or you're crazy, right? I have the soul of Jimmy Carter living in me. That was the first name that literally popped in my head. I think I saw how expensive gas was today. I think that's why that was in my head. Anyway. But this is, again, St. Paul. St. Paul is saying the words of Mary. He's saying the words of a pregnant person. It is no longer I who live, it's Christ who lives in me. Paul's heart had become so open, so impregnated with divine life, that he was bearing Christ into the world. Paul became another Christ bearer. Like this is, she is the spiritual blueprint of what every saint is. This is who you are called to be. This is Jesus's desire. And all of this, right, the birth of Christ, it's a prefigurement for the rebirth of Christ. So zooming in, this is Christ in the womb of the Virgin. Again, notice the mandorla, the iconography, the meeting place of heaven and earth. Look at the icon of the resurrection, right? The rebirth of Christ, the rebirth of Christ. The mandorla is there at the Annunciation, and it's there at the resurrection. Christ was born, this is Fulton Sheen, Christ was born in a virginal womb, and he was born again from a virginal tomb, and a Joseph did betroth them both. Joseph of Nazareth at the beginning, and Joseph of Arimathea at the end. The tomb is, again, a kind of bridal chamber. The bridegroom is taken down from the cross, he's led away, and he's laid in the tomb. Then he's put into the ground, planted, we might say, in the ground, like a seed. Unless a seed falls to the ground and dies, it will not bear fruit. But if it dies, it bears abundant fruit. Remember, tell me, what kind of offerings did the high priest make in the Holy of Holies? They were grain and seed offerings. It is the bridegroom who gives the seed. He himself is the seed. The bridegroom is the one who inseminates the bride. If we understand these connections, like what is happening on the cross, what's happening in the temple, what's happening in the Holy of Holies, when we can understand all of this, this nuptial symbolism, then we can understand then why only a man can be a priest. Where do men study to become priests? In the what?
Seminary.
You ever wonder what a man is supposed to be learning to do in the seminary? He's supposed to be learning how to inseminate the heart of the mystical bride. That's what he's supposed to be doing. To learn how to put Christ's divine life into the heart of the bride. You need a bridegroom to enter the mystery of the Holy of Holies and give the seed. Like, this is what the theology of a man's body is. This is what a man's body says. It speaks, it says, it reveals, right? I am the one who enters. Woman's body, it says, it's an icon of the Holy of Holies. It says, I open to receive. Think again, back to the Song of Songs. More Song of Songs, back to our sponsor. Song of Songs, the bridegroom comes to the bride at night. He's knocking on the door at night. He says to her, open to me, my sister, my darling, my dove, my flawless one. My head is drenched with dew, my hair with the dampness of the night. He's not just speaking about her heart, he's speaking about her body. He's her whole person. Open to me, my sister, my darling, my dove. Open to me. This scene, again, planted like a seed in the Old Testament, flowers, is fulfilled at the Annunciation. Gabriel comes to the bride. Heaven bends the knee before the bride-to-be with an unbelievable question. Open to me, my sister, my bride. Open to me. This is what Our Lady did at the Annunciation. I want to show you a quick video, and hopefully all the volume is working.
Our Lady said yes. She said yes for us all. It was as if the human race were a little dark house, without light or air, locked and latched. The wind of the Spirit had beaten on the door, rattled the windows, tapped on the dark glass with the tiny hands of flowers, flung golden seed against it even, in hours of storm, lashed it with the boughs of a great tree, the prophecy of the cross, and yet the spirit was outside. But one day, a girl opened the door, and the little house was swept pure and sweet by the wind. Seas of light swept through it, and in that little house, a child was born, and the child was God. Our Lady said yes for the human race.
Our Lady said yes for the human race. Those words are from Carol Houselander. She's a British 20th century mystic. She wrote an incredible book on Our Lady. If you're ever looking for a great book on Mary, it's called The Reed of God, R-E-E-D, Reed of God. This story, this drama, all of this, this is revealed in our bodies. It's revealed in our masculinity and our femininity. It's revealed right there in the one flesh union. How sacred is this union? How sacred is all of this, right? St. Paul was not kidding. He wasn't exaggerating when he said, this is a mega mystery. Mysterion mega. This is a great mystery. And it refers to Christ and the church. Okay, so back to our veil in the temple. The curtain is torn, which means, right, the purpose of that veil was to separate. The veil is torn, which symbolizes that we all now have entrance into these mysteries. We all now have access to the meeting place of heaven and earth, into the depth of these realities, right? The heart of God has literally been rent open so that all of us are invited into union with Jesus. All of us are invited. I'm not making this up. This is right out of the letter to the Hebrews. We are going to take a break in a few minutes. So stay with me. All right? Letters to the Hebrews, we hear this. When Christ came as high priest, think again of the high priest in the temple, he passed through the greater and more perfect tabernacle, not belonging to this creation. And he entered once and for all into the heavenly sanctuary. Like, and thus opening the gates of heaven for all of us. Like, here's again the icon of Christ, I think. This is the icon of Christ opening the gates of heaven. Again, the mandorla, right? The meeting place of heaven and earth, the place where the consummation takes place. This is what happens. This is what happens when Christ is conceived in Mary's womb. This is what happens when Christ opens the gates of heaven for us in his resurrection. Again, letter to the Hebrews. We now have confidence of entrance into the sanctuary by the new and living way he opened for us through the veil that is his flesh. Remind me, who could enter behind the veil into the sanctuary, into the Holy of Holies, in the temple? The high priest. One person, once a year. He now says, we all have confidence of entering into the place of communion. Pope Benedict, our sponsor for the night, wrote this. In the liturgy, he wrote, the curtain between heaven and earth. In the liturgy, in the Mass. Who's been to Mass? You all should raise your hand. In the Mass, the curtain between heaven and earth is torn open. It's torn open. And Christ invites us to enter behind the veil into the bridal chamber to be united with him in an eternal embrace of heaven and earth. Okay. I'm going to give you a 3 to 5 minute, maybe 2 minute, probably 3 to 5 minute stretch break, and we're going to start again in just a few minutes, all right? All right, let's stretch. God, thank you for these Catholics who have lost their seats. Help them, St. Anthony, to find their way back to their chairs so that we may begin again this drinking from the fire hydrant of your glory. The first glorious mystery. Just kidding, we're not gonna do that. In the name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit, amen. All right. Again, if you still need to stretch and go and do the things, that's fine. But we're gonna get going again. All right, how are we doing so far? Thumbs up? Okay, good. All right. I want us to contemplate this quote for a second from the Catechism. So lest you think I'm making this whole spousal thing up, the Catechism of the Catholic Church says this, the entire Christian life, how much of the Christian life? The
entire
Christian life. That's everything, folks. That's everything without remainder. The entire Christian life. It bears the mark of the spousal love of Christ and the Church. And then the Catechism has this, already baptism is a nuptial mystery. Baptism, you know, baby's head getting wet, the baptism I did today, head, candle, oil, that thing is a nuptial mystery. What makes baptism a nuptial mystery? Baptism is where we are regenerated. It's where we personally enter into this reality. Baptism is where you are inserted there. I try to add some visuals to the visuals. Are they helping? This is the first one for this slide. I don't know. Keep it, get rid of it. Okay, I'll keep it. Baptism is where you get inserted right into there. It's where you get brought into like the mystical marriage, the mystical union of Christ, the bridegroom, with the church, the bride. And where does all this happen? And again, Holy Week, Week of the Bridegroom, it happens in the font. The baptismal font, which is the womb of the church. It's the womb of the church. At the Easter Vigil, children will be born again from the womb of the church. Christians, you don't sign up to be a Christian, a Catholic. You are born. You are born. The Catechism again says this, this new birth in the Holy Spirit is signified by the perceptible elements of the sacramental rites of baptism. This new birth, this reality in the Holy Spirit, it is signified by the perceptible elements of the sacramental rites of baptism. So what are the perceptible rites of baptism that you might see if you come to the Easter Vigil? Here's what happens. Here's what's going to happen. The priest, this will be me on Saturday, the priest takes the paschal candle, which is the symbol of Christ the bridegroom, the symbol of Christ the victor, and he's going to plunge the paschal candle down into the baptismal font as he's praying for the Holy Spirit, who is the Lord and giver of
life,
to come down upon the womb of the church into the font. It's a very not so subtle symbol of what's happening. The bridegroom, the candle is plunged down into the womb of the church. This is what is inscribed right here in the baptistry of St. John Lateran in Rome. St. John Lateran, don't read it. Okay, go back. St. John Lateran, it's the mother church of all mother churches, right? It's the Pope's cathedral. Not St. Peter's, St. John Lateran. And in the baptistry of St. John Lateran, you see these words inscribed. At this font, the church, our mother, gives birth from her virginal womb to the children she conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit. Remind me in the gospel, who had a virginal womb? Who? Mary. And what spirit came upon her virginal womb? The Holy Spirit. And what was conceived there? Jesus. Okay, just want to make sure. At this font, right? Remember, Mary is the personal face of the church. The church is the ecclesial reality of Mary. The womb of the church is the font, right? Our mother gives birth from her virginal womb to what? Christians. Little Christs. That's what a Christian is. She gives birth from her womb to the children she conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit. A Vatican liturgist, he commented on this symbolism of the candle being plunged into the font. He said this, "This is profound. The meaning is profound in the plunging of the candle into the baptismal font. We can recognize in this symbolism the ritual that the priest is the fertilizing organ of the ecclesial womb. Truly, in the person of Christ the head, he, the bridegroom, engenders children. Then he fortifies them with the chrism and nourishes them with the Eucharist. By reason of the marital functions of the church as bride, the priest has to be a man because he gives the seed. All the mystical meaning of Easter is manifested in the priestly identity coming to fullness at the cross. So what's begun in the nuptials of baptism, this spousal relationship, is brought to a climax in the Eucharist, in the source and summit of our faith. There's only one sacrament that is the source and summit of the faith. It's the Eucharist. So many Catholics, I'm convinced of this, think that reconciliation is the source and summit of our faith, the forgiveness of sins. Friends, the forgiveness of sins is incredible news. Don't get me wrong, it's incredible news. It is not the nectar of the good news. Reconciliation is a means to an end. It's a means to communion. You are reconciled to the living God in order to enter into communion with Him. The good news is not merely the forgiveness of sins. The good news is that you have a God who is so wild about you, so fascinated with you, so taken by you, that He wants to join His life to your life. What begins in baptism is brought to a climax in the Eucharist. Again, the Catechism says this. Baptism is a nuptial mystery. It is, so to speak, the nuptial bath which precedes the wedding feast, the Eucharist. The Eucharist. John Paul II says the Eucharist is the source. I wanted that quote. It's the source and summit. The Eucharist is the sacrament of the bridegroom and the bride, John Paul II says. The Eucharist, I want to make sure you're hearing me. The Eucharist, not matrimony, where you actually have a bridegroom and a bride. No, the Eucharist is the sacrament of the bridegroom and the bride. The Eucharist reveals the full meaning of our masculinity and femininity. Like in this sublime mystery, this sublime gift, you and I receive and participate in an intimacy, a union with God, a holy communion, that the only earthly analogy is that of spousal intimacy. And that is a spark compared to the supernova of the reality. Again, when we talk about these analogies, there is similarity between the sign and the thing signified. There's a similarity between spousal intimacy and the intimacy of Christ in the church. But the dissimilarity between these things is infinitely greater than the similarity, which means that the intimacy that God wants with you, that God seeks to have with you through this gift, is infinitely more than the relationship of husband and wife. In this sacrament, He quite literally gives us His heart. The Eucharist is, again, as I said, where God fully reveals to us the meaning of our masculinity and femininity. The bridegroom is the one who gives himself to the bride. Notice that you don't come forward and thank you very much, and thank you very much. Like, you don't come forward and take. You come forward to receive. The bride walks down the aisle to meet her bridegroom, and she opens and she receives divine life into her. the bridegroom gives himself to the bride. The fully aware of all of this nuptial symbolism that I've been talking about, the Eastern Rite Church, they've composed these ancient, beautiful hymns that get chanted throughout the week of the bridegroom. Listen to this one. O Passover, save us from sorrow, for today Christ has shone forth from the tomb as from a bridal chamber and filled the women with joy. He's left the tomb as if from a bridal chamber and filled the women who came to the tomb with joy. What does Jesus say in the gospel? He says, I wish that my joy would be in you and your joy would be complete. He also says, I want my life in you that your life might be fulfilled. His joy is his life. It is his love. He's saying, I want what's in me to be in you. Easter joy, it's the openness of the bride to the newness of life that's coming from the bridegroom. Right? The openness of the bride to the gift of the bridegroom. And all of creation is singing this song this time of year around Easter, right? In springtime. Right now, everything is just starting to like come alive. Right? Driving down Summit Street, those trees are starting to look a little red. The buds are coming, right? Everything is coming alive. This new life is springing forth. Flowers are blooming and they're sending their fragrance and wafting through the air. And soon everyone with seasonal allergies are going to be tortured. Do you know what is happening when you're experiencing seasonal allergies? Do you know what pollen is? It's plant sperm. What's happening when you have an allergic reaction is a plant is trying to mate with your nose. And your nose is saying, no! I'm just telling you, I'm not a botanist, but I just play one on TV. All right, question. What will our church, what will all churches be covered with Easter morning? Flowers. Yeah, and pollen. What will people smell when they walk into our church on Easter Sunday? Flowers, lilies. And what is a flower? It is creation's openness to new life. A flower is, strictly speaking, so we're going to take another step. A flower is, strictly speaking, one of nature's most beautiful reproductive organs, is what a flower is. That's what a flower is. It's feminine openness. What causes the closed petals of a flower to open? The sun. The sun causes the petals to open. What does the bride carry in her hands as she walks down the aisle on her wedding day? Flowers. Flowers. Back to this image of the nuptial cross. Mary, in the tradition, she's known as the mystical rose. What do people smell when Mary shows up apparitions. What do people smell? Roses. Roses. Why? I got this one from Christopher West, so this is not a Patrick Schultz original. He says this, and it's so good. It's not because Mary smells like roses. It's because the roses smell like Mary. She's the mystical rose. She's the pinnacle of created fertility. She's the pinnacle of feminine openness. All of the other flowers are mimicking her. She's the mystical rose. She's the mystical rose. And what is she holding in this image? She's holding the chalice to receive the flow of blood and water. What is a chalice? It comes from, the Latin is calyx, What is a calyx? A calyx is a very particular anatomical part of the flower. The calyx's job is to collect moisture, to collect the dew drops in the morning. It's essential for the reproductive pollinization process of the flower. And the chalice, traditionally, according to the Roman Missal, according to the germ, the chalice, it's most fitting for the chalice to be veiled at the start of Mass. The flower, the symbol of the bride, of openness, the chalice, it's placed on the altar at Mass. And again, it's veiled. And what is the altar? The church has always seen the altar. Yes, it's a place of sacrifice, but it's the marriage bed. It's the marriage bed where the mystical marriage of heaven and earth takes place. Heaven comes down to earth. It's like at the Mass, at the epiclesis, when we call down the Holy Spirit, it's like we are all inside of Mary's womb at the moment of the Annunciation. Like we are witnessing again what took place 2,000 years ago when she said yes, the Holy Spirit comes down upon created matter and it transforms it into the substance of Christ. The altar is the marriage bed where the marriage of heaven and earth with Christ and the church is consummated, right? Deacon Rich sets the chalice on the altar, but who unveils the chalice? The priest, because the priest is the bridegroom. The priest is the bridegroom. Who else is veiled at Mass? A lot of women in our parish, I will say that. That's for sure. But iconically, traditionally, who wears a veil? The bride. And who unveils the bride? The bridegroom. Right? So the elements are placed on the altar. The priest prays over them. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the
dewfall.
The dewfall. Recall what Pope Benedict said about the Song of Songs. It's the essence of biblical faith. What does the bridegroom say to the bride when he comes to her at night? He says, open to me, my sister, my darling, my dove, my flawless one. My head is drenched with
dew.
My hair with the dampness of the night. The bridegroom is coming to the bride. Ephatha, open to me. My sister, my bride, my darling, my flawless one, open to me. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall. Mystery of mysteries. The Mass is the nuptials between heaven and earth. Listen to another hymn from the Byzantine Church. When you arose from the tomb, O Christ, you preserved its seal intact. Just as in your holy birth a virgin's vow was unbroken, you opened to us the gates of paradise. You see right there in that hymn, speaking of Mary's body, connecting it immediately to the gates of paradise. Like all of these things have been open to us because of what Christ did on the cross. John, in his gospel, he tells us pretty emphatically on Easter morning that Peter and John race to the tomb. John gets there first. I always imagine that scene, right? They race to the tomb and John, you know, because he's younger, John's like, beat ya! And Peter's like, no one's ever going to know. And John's like, oh, yeah? And the other disciple got there first, you know? Why else would he have put that in there? I don't know. Just eternal bragging rights. So, anyway, they get to the tomb. John waits, right, because John represents the mystical and Peter represents the authority, right? So the mystical in the church always lags behind the authoritative. It's kind of a good thing, right? Peter looks in, he sees the burial shroud and the folded napkin from the face set off to a separate place.
Was he wrapped in a burial shroud? Yes. Yes, we heard it in today's gospel. Joseph of Arimathea buys a linen. They embalm him in hundreds of pounds of aloes and spices. He is wrapped in a burial shroud. And yet the burial shroud, you have to picture like a hollowed out, flattened balloon. Like it's in the shape of a body, but there's no body in there. What does this mean? Catechism tells us this. This signifies that Christ's body had escaped the bonds of death and corruption. Whose body in here is subject to corruption and death? Raise your hand. Everybody. Every day. I wish I'd taken some Aleve before we started this tonight, because my hamstrings are screaming, right? The bonds of death and corruption. We are stuck in this realm of death and decay, every single one of us. Like every day we wake up, we're another day closer to the grave. We are all headed to the grave. Christ's body, it has escaped the bonds of death and corruption. We're going to come back to this in the end. So Christ, the new Adam, he comes out of the ground in a garden. Did you ever notice that? That the passion narrative that we're going to hear on Friday, it begins in a garden and it ends in a garden. Right? It begins in the Garden of Gethsemane, and then at the end, his body's taken down and it says, in a garden close by, there was a new tomb freshly cut in the rock. The new Adam, buried in the ground, emerges from the ground in a garden, just as the first Adam did. And the first Adam, remind me, he comes up out of the ground, the Lord creates him, and he is naked, yes or no? Yes. In fact, the author of Genesis says that he is naked and he felt no shame. The new Adam comes up out of the ground in the garden, not wrapped in the burial bonds like Lazarus. He is free of the burial bonds. He comes up out of the ground like the first Adam, naked and fragrant. Fragrant with the garden's nard. This is why Michelangelo, when he depicted the resurrected Christ, this is his image of the resurrected Christ. Naked and without shame. Friends, this is what Easter, this is what Holy Week, this is what the week of the bridegroom, it is all about. It's about this divine life. And where does that flow from? Where does that life come from? We cannot understand the supernatural reality of new life unless we know the reality of natural life, right? Jesus says to Nicodemus, unless you are born again, you cannot enter the kingdom of God. And Nicodemus is like, surely you cannot re-enter your mother's womb. And Jesus, notice that he doesn't say, that's not what I'm talking about. Jesus says to him, how can you, as a Pharisee, who, if you don't understand this, if you don't understand the natural reality, how are you going to understand what I'm talking about? Unless you are born again, unless we are born, like we're all born of the first Adam and the first Eve. We all have this natural life and we all have this inheritance of original sin. We must be born again of the new Adam and the new Eve, Christ and the church. Remember that image with the arrow? Like we must be entered into that. We must be born of the union of Christ and the church. We have to enter into that. This is what Easter morning is. This is the recreation of the universe, right? Jesus coming up out of the ground. He's fragrant with nard. Because that nard, back to this, that nard was poured on him in preparation for his burial, he says. Right, 6 days before Passover, Jesus came to Bethany. While reclining, a woman approached him with a jar of nard. She broke the jar and poured it on his head. In pouring this perfumed oil upon my body, she did it to prepare me for my burial. Wherever the gospel is proclaimed in the whole world, what she has done will be spoken of in memory of her. Here's what I want you to hone in on. Jesus would have smelled of nard throughout the entirety of Holy Week, the entirety of the week of the bridegroom. He would have smelled of the nard. A whole liter was poured on his head. You don't scrub that off pretty easy. He enters into Gethsemane and he smells of the nard. He's hauled before Pilate, fragrant with nard. This reminder, I'm opening the gates of paradise. I'm putting my divine life into the heart of the bride. The tradition had happened in, had grown up in ancient Judaism, that on the Feast of Passover, the rabbis would be chanting the entirety of the Old Testament. And they would have, around the 3 o'clock hour, when Jesus is hanging on the cross outside of the city, they would have arrived at, timing-wise, they would have arrived at the Song of Songs. He would have been on the cross, outside of the city, hearing the Song of Songs, hearing his bride crying out to him. And there he is, pouring out the gift of divine life. He would have smelled of the nard on the cross. He would have smelled of nard going into the tomb. He would have smelled of nard when he turned the tomb into a womb. That's what he did. He turned the tomb into a womb. The glorious new Adam smelling like nard. We're going to end with our sponsor, Pope Benedict, again. It's in the Song of Songs where we see the full truth of this nuptial mystery on display, right? The full truth of Good Friday, the full truth of Easter Sunday. The meaning of all of this, why it matters. To the Christian, he says, faith in the resurrection of Jesus Christ, it's an expression of certainty that the saying that seems to be only a beautiful dream is in fact true. Love is strong as death. In the Old Testament, this sentence comes in the middle of praises of the power of Eros. In the Song of Songs, the lovers, the bridegroom and the bride, are crying out, wanting a love to be stronger than death. Because why? Because we're all bound in this corruption of death. Right? Jesus, back to that catechism quote, the empty shroud symbolizes he's breaking free of the bonds of corruption and death. The lovers in the Song of Songs, you and me, all day long, we are bound by corruption and death. Everybody you know, everything you love, everything will come to an end. We are bound by this, and these lovers in the Song of Songs are crying out, is there a love that's stronger than death? Is there a place of forever where beauty doesn't fade, where goodness doesn't fade, where life doesn't fade, where you don't have to say goodbye? Is there such a thing? And Pope Benedict is saying, this cry for love is strong in death, it seems like a beautiful dream. But this by no means signifies that we can simply push it aside as a lyrical exaggeration. The boundless demands of Eros. Your heart has Eros. You are made of Eros. Maybe it's anesthetized. Maybe it's been numbed out. Maybe it's been put to sleep by a lot of different distractions. But you have a heart that longs for fulfillment, that longs for not just life, but life. You have a heart that doesn't just want some beauty. You have a heart that wants for endless beauty, for endless relationships. You don't want to say goodbye to anybody that you love. You don't want life to end. You don't want to just tell yourself pious platitudes like, oh, they're in a better place. Forget that. I want them back. You have a heart that's filled with Eros, with longing and passion. The boundless demands of Eros, its apparent exaggerations and its extravagance. We're embarrassed by how much we want. We're embarrassed by how much we thirst and hunger. But it's there. The boundless demands of Eros, its apparent exaggerations and extravagance, they do give expression to a basic problem, indeed the basic problem of human existence, insofar as they reflect the nature and intrinsic paradox of love. Love demands infinity, indestructibility. Indeed, it is, so to speak, a call for infinity. When you come, when you came to the altar on the day of your wedding, I promised to love you in good times and in bad, in sickness and in health, to love and to cherish for 15 years. Love pushes us to eternity. Until death do us part, love pushes us to eternity. Love has boundless demands. And he says the basic problem of human existence is that we demand infinity, but we can't give it to ourselves. That's what Easter proclaims to us. When Jesus steps forth out of this tomb, fragrant with the nard of the bride, fragrant, free from the corruption, the bonds of death. He's whispering to your heart. The bridegroom is whispering to your heart. Your heart is not stupid. Your heart's not dumb. You are indeed made for forever beauty, forever bliss, forever love. This is what resurrection means. Not just that we get to live forever. It means that your heart will be perfectly, infinitely satisfied. Not in this life. Never in this life. That's why the Eucharist is a pledge of future glory. We say it at the beginning of every Mass. O sacred banquet in which Christ is received. Say it with me. The memory of his passion is recalled. The soul is filled with grace. And planetary future glory is given us. A pledge is a promise. It's a promise. He's promised us. You will not be forever sad. You will not be forever disappointed. It's coming. Attach your humanity to me. Attach your desires to me. I will bring you there. All of this somehow is revealed in the center of the Bible with those two words, nard, nard. The fragrance of the bride is the fragrance of Easter morning. Of openness. It is all he wants from you. Your openness. Between now and eternity, every closed part of your heart will be opened. Everything in the dark will be brought into the light, not because he wants to shine with cruelty. It's because he wants every part of you to be touched by every part of him. And the first person who did all of this, the first person who lived the Song of Songs, was Our Lady. We're going to end by praying the litany of Our Lady. I'm going to turn to her now. The open vessel of longing, the spouse of the Holy Spirit, the mystical rose. And we ask her to pray for us that we, like her, would lift up our hearts to the Lord, that we would lift up the chalices of our hearts to his heart, that we might receive and drink deeply as she did. After each of these invocations, Please respond with pray for us. Mary, our mother.
Pray for us.
New Eve.
Pray for us.
Woman clothed with the sun.
Pray for us.
Woman most beautiful.
Pray for us.
Garden of the new Adam.
Pray for us.
Virginal paradise.
Pray for us.
God's Eden.
Pray for us.
Garden enclosed.
Pray for us.
Earth unsown.
Pray for us.
Mystical rose.
Pray for us.
Flower of Carmel.
Pray for us.
Mystic bride.
Pray for us.
Bride of the Song of Songs.
Pray for us.
Spotless bride of Christ.
Pray for us.
Bride of Joseph.
Pray for us.
Open vessel of longing.
Pray for us.
Open gate of heaven.
Pray for us.
Open gate of dawn.
Pray for us.
Eastern gate.
Pray for us.
Created temple of the Creator.
Pray for us.
Dwelling place for God.
Pray for us.
Vessel that contains God.
Pray for us.
Ark of the New Covenant.
Pray for us.
Temple of God.
Pray for us.
Living heaven.
Pray for us.
Holy chamber more spacious than the heavens.
Pray for us.
Holy chamber of virginal wedlock.
Pray for us.
Bridal chamber of immortality.
Pray for us.
Bridal chamber made by God.
Pray for us.
Virgin most powerful.
Pray for us.
Immaculate conception.
Pray for us.
Immaculate heart.
Pray for us.
Nature's recreation.
Pray for us.
Nature's restoration.
Pray for us.
Holy in soul and body.
Pray for us.
Healing balm of integrity.
Pray for us.
My body's healing.
Pray for us.
Consoler of the afflicted.
Pray for us.
Vessel rich in mercy.
Pray for us.
Untire of knots.
Pray for us.
Crusher of heresies.
Pray for us.
Cause of our joy.
Pray for us.
Our Lady of the Assumption.
Pray for us.
Our Lady of Confidence.
Pray for us.
Our Lady of the Milk.
Pray for us.
Nursing Madonna.
Pray for us.
Nourisher of God and man.
Pray for us.
Mother of fairest love.
Pray for us.
Mother of the world.
Pray for us.
Star of the new evangelization.
Pray for us.
Ravisher of hearts.
Pray for us.
O Blessed Mother, we beg of you to pray for us that we would be fertile soil for your Son, seed, for the blood that's pouring out and the life that's being spent and given. We pray that we would be like those baby birds, open, stretching, pining, longing, overwhelmed by the immensity of your love and the particularity of your love. That you don't love us in generalities, Father. You love us in particularities. You love us. You are fascinated by us, riveted, ravished, captivated. Give us the grace, Father, to enter into this week, the week of the bridegroom, and let us stand in awe on that Easter morn. May we be like all those flowers, the petals of our hearts laid bare to receive the rising sun. And all this we ask through Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
My dear friends, the Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. Go in peace. Thanks. Thanks, everybody.